Let us pray. Humble servant King, Lord Jesus, teach us by your example. Help us in your way. Wash us clean. Touch us with your love. And in doing so, prepare us and ready us to be your servants. Humble servant King, Lord Jesus. Amen. Well, on Palm Sunday, I had us looking at a donkey that Jesus rode into Jerusalem. And I have to tell you, I was a little insecure about choosing that focus, okay? It might have seemed at first a little lighthearted or, you know, anyway, I decided by now, at this point in Holy Week, that was a great choice because it signaled Jesus' intentions for being a king of peace, coming with peaceful intentions. We talked about how he was fulfilling an Old Testament prophecy and God's command in Deuteronomy 17 that God wanted to give the people a king who didn't rely on armies to keep the peace, but God wanted to give his people a king of peace. There couldn't have been any greater contrast between Jesus' palm parade and Pontius Pilate and his Roman cohort. Military might fully displayed. Cavalry, foot soldiers, banners, golden staffs topped with the Roman imperial symbol, the eagle. A message of domination, fear, and force. Jesus rode on the colt of a donkey, small enough for Jesus' feet to touch the ground. He rolled like that into the city that kills prophets. And however foolish that might have looked, he would not waver in his way. So looking at that donkey was a good place to start and begin to see that every last action of Christ was to show his way of bringing peace to the world. And so it is tonight. It was brave to ride a donkey into Jerusalem. And on that last night, at that Last Supper, I have reflected on how Christ showed personal and emotional bravery in the company of his disciples, and then the bravery of Good Friday. And I don't know why I keep using that word bravery, but it just seemed to express the fullest amount of faithfulness in these last days. Maundy Thursday is in between two very public events. It's a very personal nexus that we look at tonight. Jesus and his close friends gathered for the Passover meal. And despite the heartache he must have felt, he was there at that table with them, overcoming his own friends' fallibility. I found myself digging into the origin of that word fallible from the Latin verb. It's almost like to fall, fallere, to fall, which actually means to deceive. But it's used in a whole continuum of a way to describe human the potential for human error. Who speaks Latin? I don't, so I had to spell this out phonetically. We'll see if you can translate this. Errare humanum est. What does that mean? You know the expression, actually. To err is human. And the root word of that, though, comes from fallible. That describes that continuing character flaws or fallibility to deception, to purposeful deception. And all of that was present, wasn't it, that night in his friends. They loved Jesus. They saw him as the Messiah. They expected great things to come. And yet they were fallible in their faith. And how often had Jesus called them to have more faith? That if they had enough faith, they could move mountains. He declared to them. John wrote in his gospel about the beginning of this night that having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. What a remarkable statement of love. He never gave up. He trusted God's way of love 100%, even knowing them, knowing their fallibility and their flaws and the deceit in Judas' heart. He was unswayed at the table with them. He took the ancient Passover meal and he made a new covenant to deliver them all, God's people and all people. And then he doubled their lesson, doubled their grace by washing their feet, washing each one of them personally. And isn't it true for you and me that in order to truly be changed and converted, that we must be touched personally by Christ? That's the goal of Lent. It's a season of conversion to turn us back to Christ. Touching us through the love and grace of his Son. Think about the extraordinary nature of these acts of our Lord. Knowing that they wouldn't understand now, but later. We know all too well the things that make for brokenness in our relationships and in our world. We gather tonight stung again by loss, praying for the people of Brussels and how we long for peace. Maybe there is a much closer need for peace that brings you here tonight. A rift in your home between spouses, parent and child, a betrayal, or the weight of our own guilt. When we come into the sanctuary, we know Christ's peace is near. But how do we receive it? And how do we bring that peace back home where it's needed? We can talk to God's Son right now, tonight. We can give him our struggle and let him lead us into his peace. Through the example that he has given us. It wasn't easy for Christ. And to appreciate how difficult it is for us to forgive someone, even about small things. Just think about a time when you followed a generous impulse, or just even a faithful desire to forgive when you weren't motivated. And you showed someone grace, and it wasn't reciprocated. My guess is that the whole thing backfired, and you left more angry with that person than before, because they didn't reciprocate. But Jesus forgave without regard to response, and that makes it extraordinary. He trusted 100% God's way to bring peace, loving fallible friends to the end. Once a year, we revisit Christ's lesson of grace and forgiveness, but it's meant for every day. And see how he makes holy those everyday places and daily tasks and our daily conversations, from his table to your kitchen table. Let his peace be shared. In the washing of clothes or the washing away of bygones, let his peace be shared. Let it be shared from person to person and nation to nation, that his kingdom of peace will come. Starting here again, as we always do. Tonight I invite you to be washed and fed by Christ. And in either place, to say, I'm sorry. No more. Just that, to cover everything. Just say it to Christ tonight. Say it not for the sins that you see in yourself, that you can see with your own eyes, but ask God to forgive you for what he sees through his eyes. Like Jesus, who looked on his friends, and in doing so, grasp humility. And come to his table, where a welcome is already extended, even before you say, I'm sorry. And then hear him say something extraordinary. The bread and the wine and his life forgiven, given for you. He says, all is forgiven. Come just like those fallible disciples, fallible but loved by God's Son. And having been loved then, and forgiven to the utmost, and leaving here with Christ's sure promise, he will love you to the end. Then go and do likewise. Take that first step and offer a gesture of grace or an act of humble service. Be persistent. Be confident. Look to the needs of others and trust God's way. And oh, what hope will be stirred in lives, in this world. Touch the broken with Christ's love, just as Christ has touched the broken in you. And the peace of Christ will be with you.